Major funding for KPBS Evening Edition has been made possible in part by Anderson Plumbing, Heating and Air, proud to support the mission of KPBS and privileged to serve San Diego clients. Anderson Plumbing, Heating and Air, helping homeowners maintain drain, heating and cooling systems since 1978. And by the Conrad Prebis Foundation, Darlene Marco Shiley, and by the following. By viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening. It's Friday, December 18th. Thank you for joining us. I'm Maya Trabulsi. San Diego County is appealing a judge's ruling allowing two strip clubs and all county restaurants to be open despite state-imposed COVID-19 restrictions. KPBS reporter Matt Hoffman has the latest.
The board voted to appeal the judge's order, but directed county attorneys to only argue it's incorrect relating to strip clubs and indoor dining. A statement from Chair Greg Cox says the board supports outdoor dining with appropriate safety protocols. The state of California is also appealing, arguing the judge's ruling thwarts public health efforts to avoid overwhelming hospitals.
We are entering our darkest phase and darkest hour, and then it continues to sow public confusion and doubt when a judge comes out and says, I don't see a link between restaurants and COVID cases.
For now, though, county officials have stopped enforcing closures for the two strip clubs and all restaurants.
You don't know the reality, what's going to happen. Right now, it could change. Hey, go back just to go. And then we have to move all the setup. And it's time and money.
In Chula Vista, Casa Victoria owner Victor Valencia just today reopened his restaurant for dine-in service.
But as you see, we're super slow because people are scared.
Valencia had the grand opening here just a few months ago in August.
Middle of the pandemic, so it's been really tough. All my savings, my time, my gas, my kids. So we've been 24/7 trying to hang in here.
He says just takeout alone is not cutting it, and he has to try to bring back dine-in sales to keep the doors open and employees on the payroll.
I'm going to try to hang in there. One either way or other way, I have to make it. I don't know how I'm going to make it, but I'm waiting to see if the government's going to help us.
In East Chula Vista, Papagayo's Grill and Cantina is at least for now back open to dine in inside or out.
It made a big difference, a positive difference for all of us.
Head server Hector Meza says they're following all sanitation, masking, and socially distancing guidelines.
Adjusting and investing. All this here takes a lot of money invested to make it happen. We all have families to support. We all have bills to pay. Especially this time of year, the holiday season, it's tough as it is.
But Meza 2 doesn't know how long they will be able to seat guests for.
It's been hard to stay above water with all the changes. It seems like every week it's something new.
Matt Hoffman, KPBS News.
Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine was just authorized for emergency use by the Food and Drug Administration. And it can't come soon enough as California experiences the biggest surge of the pandemic. San Diego County is averaging 30 to 40 more hospitalizations a day compared to mid-October. ICU capacity for the Southern California region dropped to 0%. The president and CEO of the Hospital Association of San Diego and Imperial Counties says that he doesn't mean there's no space. That doesn't mean that there's no space. There are 84 open beds, but only 30 of those are staffed. He says staffing is the main concern.
With the nurses and doctors and other clinicians, I mean, they've been at this for 9 to 10 months. So folks are exhausted, but they're continuing to push forward. And that's where, you know, we continue to hope that folks will stay home and do all the right things so that we can start to bend this curve and create some relief with vaccines on the horizon.
The state is opening field hospitals to help with the overflow, and some surgeries are being canceled. The San Diego Convention Center will continue providing services for people experiencing homelessness. The emergency shelter has been operating since April. Today, Mayor Todd Gloria directed city staff to fund it through January using unspent money earmarked for shelters and state grants. He's proposing that the city authorize additional funding to keep it open through March. Another major announcement from the mayor. He is rejecting SDG&E's bid for the city's gas and electric franchise as unresponsive. and canceling the current invitation to bid process. Gloria says he will be pursuing an extension of the existing agreement with SDG&E to allow enough time for the new city council to get up to speed and allow more opportunities for public input. The Senate just passed a two-day stopgap funding measure that President Trump must sign by midnight to avert a government shutdown. But they're still trying to agree on a stimulus plan. Nadia Romero has the latest from Washington.
And with that, Vice President Mike Pence gets the Pfizer-BioNTech COVID-19 vaccine.
All of us have a role to play. The way through this challenging time is vigilance and a vaccine.
Some lawmakers began getting the vaccine Friday, including House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell.
So I'm sure it's not going to be perfect.
Republicans and Democrats back at the Capitol trying to work out two deals, a $900 billion COVID-19 relief plan tied to a $1.4 trillion funding package, all before the government shuts down this weekend for the holidays.
I'm even more optimistic now than I was last night that a bipartisan bicameral framework for a major rescue package is very close at hand.
But some lawmakers remain less optimistic about negotiations.
I think we may need a short-term extension of government funding in order to make sure that both of the bills are done and that we can pass them.
Republicans want to add a provision to limit the Federal Reserve's emergency lending authority. And for some Democrats, it's a deal breaker.
Why in the world would we limit the ability of the next president of the United States and his administration to crush the virus, to provide direct assistance and relief to the American people, and to revive our economy?
In Washington, Nadia Romero, KPBS News.
The U.S. Supreme Court declined to rule on a Trump administration policy that would exclude undocumented people from this year's census count. KPBS reporter Max Rivlin-Nadler tells us this leaves immigrant communities on edge.
The Supreme Court said it would be premature to rule on a memo sent by President Trump to the Census Bureau, which directed the Bureau to exclude undocumented people from this year's census count, something that's never been done before. This comes after a failed years-long effort to include a citizenship question on the census, which critics say was meant to depress turnout among immigrant communities.
It's an attack on the constitutional principles that we were founded on. I don't think it can be understated.
Alora Calderon with the Employee Rights Center in City Heights said that with the economic fallout of the pandemic hitting immigrant communities hard, not counting undocumented people would be disastrous. Much of these communities' federal support is based on the census.
It could mean the closure of schools. And what are you going to have? Thousands of children without education for years? I mean, the consequences, even though the court did not rule on it, by not making a clear statement, they're leaving the possibility that these families could be left without being part of the apportionment.
For months, community organizations have tried to get an accurate census count, dealing with a pandemic on top of administration-led suppression efforts. The Supreme Court's conservative justices supported today's decision. Three liberal justices dissented. Brenda Diaz thinks the court's pushback to immigrants comes from the community's growing power.
They see the power of this large population, right, and how it'll shift representation not only at the local level but at the national level if in fact they are counted. And so I think that's what they're afraid of and why they would vote accordingly, because of the shift in power and obviously the money that would be coming into the states with larger immigrant populations.
The president has pledged to finalize some version of the census by the time he leaves office. If that doesn't include undocumented people, immigrant groups say it's unconstitutional and have pledged to sue again. Max Rivlin-Nadler, KPBS News.
Poway Unified officials have voted to suspend in-person learning for a month. All students will learn from home when classes resume after winter break, January 4th through the 15th. The decision is to help minimize the spread of illnesses. The district says they have no evidence, however, of outbreaks on any of their campuses. Volunteers in the COVID-19 vaccine trials get either the real thing or a placebo, but they don't know which. In this pandemic profile, KPBS health reporter Taryn Mento introduces us to two volunteers who think they've figured out who got what.
Cheese.
The inside of Jennifer Bernal's home is full of smiles and playtime with her wife and two kids.
Look at my baby walking.
Yeah.
Good job, Mama.
It was a different tone back in February. Her wife suffered complications after giving birth to their daughter, and at one point, she was on a ventilator.
I was terrified and trying to hold it together, but I had somebody come and, like, bring donated breast milk for my 10-day-old daughter, and she asked me how I was doing, and that was it. I just broke down.
Her wife recovered and returned home shortly before the state's stay-home order in March. But the experience prompted Bernal to enroll in a trial to test a vaccine developed by Moderna. It's how she could help potential COVID-19 patients from going through what her wife did.
And I got to be with her. Her sister got to be with her. And I was reading about all of these people being admitted to the hospital and being alone. And the only contact they had was with people in masks and shields on their face and these crazy suits. And it's just, I mean, I was terrified. I can't imagine what those patients are going through right now.
She also wanted the immunity to protect her and her family. But the lack of side effects from her injection left her disappointed.
There wasn't even a tender arm after, like, a flu shot.
Bernal thinks her painless injection is a sign she got the placebo. Meanwhile, her cousin and fellow trial participant, Alicia Martinez, experienced a sore shoulder, fatigue, and an itchy underarm.
I did get worried. I was like, oh my God, am I going to have an itchy armpit forever? Because it was, like, really itchy. And then my arm just, like, not being able to lift it.
She followed Bernal into the study because she, too, wanted protection to help keep her three daughters safe. But a child she once nannied for was also part of her decision. The little girl, Angie, had a condition that made her vulnerable to even a common cold. She died from the mitochondrial syndrome at 19 months old.
For her, I wish there would have been a cure for what she had. And so with this, I know there's people who are losing their loved ones. And if I can help somebody else not have to have that kind of pain and stuff, I'm open to doing my part.
Martinez's side effects from the trial were brief and among the common reactions reported. But Bernal is convinced it means her cousin got what she calls the good stuff.
You know, sometimes you get shots and it gets that hard ball where the shot was injected, and I had that too. And so Jen actually measured it out for me. She was like so jealous. She was like, I didn't get a hard ball. But it did go away and it was fine.
Bernal says there's no hard feelings.
Obviously, I really wanted the immunity, but I'm glad for her because she does have three kids. She is a single mom and she needs to be as healthy as possible to take care of her family.
But it's unclear when they'll know for sure which dose they each got. Moderna will be the second emergency approved vaccine after Pfizer. Federal regulators must decide if the companies can inform a study's placebo participants and offer them the emergency approved vaccine when eligible. Taryn Mento, KPBS News.
Dog owners are on alert after a bacterial outbreak was announced by the County Health and Human Services Agency. As KPBS reporter Jacob Ayer tells us, it can cause acute kidney injury in dogs.
Since October, the county said there have been 34 confirmed and probable cases of leptospirosis, mostly in the Hillcrest and Mission Hills areas. Several dogs required hospitalization, and at least one was euthanized. The bacteria is not new, but it is less common in drier regions. Dog owner Seaver Soon is a resident in Mission Hills who says he's worried for his pup, Archer.
It's definitely concerning that there's this new infection that most dogs in San Diego aren't routinely vaccinated against. And so, I want to get educated on the topic.
Leptospirosis spreads through contact with urine from an infected animal. Oftentimes it is spread through dogs, but humans can contract the bacteria as well. Understanding where the bacteria spreads is a critical aspect of preventing more cases.
Leptospirosis is spread through infected urine, and dogs come in contact with it with their mucous membranes or cuts on their skin. And so common places that we are going to see it here in San Diego are going to be the dog parks, dog beaches, and boarding facilities. So places where dogs are urinating and other dogs are potentially coming in contact with it.
Signs of leptospirosis in dogs are wide-ranging and can include fever, muscle weakness, vomiting, diarrhea, loss of appetite, low energy, and frequent urination, which may even contain blood. Dr. Jenna Olson works at B Street Veterinary Hospital and says the good news is that a vaccine is available and the disease is treatable with antibiotics.
With treatment, luckily, it can be 70 to 80%. There is a 70 to 80% survival rate, and that treatment can vary depending on the severity of the illness. As long as dogs are vaccinated for it, if they come in contact with it, they should be okay.
No human cases have been linked to this outbreak in dogs, but anyone who develops fever, headache, muscle aches, especially in the back and calves, or other illnesses after contact with a sick dog, should see their healthcare provider. Jacob Ayer, KPBS News.
The unemployment rate in San Diego dropped to 6.6% in November. That's according to figures released today by the State Employment Development Department. The jobless rate is down from 7.5% in October. However, the November data does not include regional stay-at-home orders put in place by Governor Gavin Newsom. Christmas is 1 week away. In the Friday Business Reports, SDSU's Miro Kopic explains how holiday shopping has changed during the pandemic.
You know, initially there was a lot of optimism. The National Retail Federation, the Monday before Thanksgiving, increased their forecast. The fact of the matter is that that has not been the case. Foot traffic was down 52%. During those 5 days between Thanksgiving and Cyber Monday. Studies are indicating that, you know, overall retail foot traffic will be down about 25% this holiday season. So that's a major concern to retailers, many of whom, especially small retailers, you know, have about 25% of their total retail sales or more during these last couple of months. There won't be the big discounts. You know, the discounts have been relatively mild at this point time of the year. Now, depending on different retailers and their circumstances, they may actually increase the discounts beginning today all the way through Christmas Day to move that last bit of merchandise.
Of the many things the pandemic has taken from us is the ability to gather together. At this time of year, it's especially tough for a lot of seniors who look forward to time with friends and family. But as KPBS reporter John Carroll shows us, seniors in one San Diego neighborhood got the next best thing.
Drive-through events. They've become a familiar part of the pandemic. Seniors have been driving through to pick up food here at the George L. Stevens Senior Center in Skyline for months. But today, a week before Christmas, was different. The food came with some holiday cheer.
We have a potted plant.
But not just any potted plant. It's the holiday season, so only a poinsettia will do.
We have stocking stuffers.
Inside those bright red and white stockings, handcrafted holiday greeting cards, and another kind of card everybody likes to get, gift cards.
I think they can bring them out.
Rosemary Pope is in charge of this merry event, but the executive director of the Stevens Senior Center got plenty of help from some volunteers.
All right, sweetheart, take care. All right. Merry Christmas.
We wanted to enhance and embrace that quality of their lives in spite of the COVID-19.
They're making us feel extra special because we have goodie bags, we're giving poinsettias.
In pre-pandemic times, Brenda Lassane and her husband were regulars here. She says it's a life-giving place for seniors.
Before the pandemic, we could come here, we could exercise, we could do classes, and it's the best place for any senior.
Of course, those activities will return once the pandemic is past.
Hi, Merry Christmas.
But for today, some sustenance mixed with the holiday spirit was just the ticket.
The motto of this senior center is enhancing and embracing seasoned minds. And while embracing obviously isn't possible right now, there was certainly a lot of enhancing going on here today. In the Skyline neighborhood, John Carroll, KPBS News.
A little something extra was handed out along with free meals for families in the San Diego Unified School District. The Old Globe donated 1,000 Dr. Seuss books for students at three grab-and-go meal distribution sites, including this one at Porter North Elementary. This year, the Old Globe's production of How the Grinch Stole Christmas will be performed Sunday and Christmas Eve on KPBS 89.5 FM. And we all love the traditions of the holidays, but sadly, house fires are among those. One of the most common are fires started by lights and electrical issues on Christmas trees. And today, fire crews did a demonstration to show how quickly those fires start and how fast they spread. They also remind you to avoid letting your tree dry out. Keep it in water. Also, be sure to check those bulbs and wires for defects.
Had a little bit of a breeze out there, but those winds are finally decreasing. As we head through this weekend, we're looking pretty good. And if you like warmer times to come, we are going to see some of those numbers on the rise in the days ahead. First up, though, tonight, temperatures dropping back into the 30s and 40s in some locations. 45 for San Diego itself, Oceanside coming in at 35, Borrego Springs in the mid-30s for year low as we transition into the weekend. Lots of dry air in place. The moisture that's going to work its way into the west remains in the northwest. So Washington, Oregon, maybe Northern California. But in our area, we're far away from it. And with the quiet weather settling in, temperatures will be on the rise. So really, our story is just some mild times. 71 for the high tomorrow in San Diego. Meanwhile, Chula Vista coming in at 69. As you venture into a lot of our interior locations, we're still finding 60s and 70s on the board. So it is a mild time, and that continues through Saturday, Sunday, and into Monday. High pressure still taking hold here and keeping things warmer than average. Some of us even pushing the upper 70s. Your forecast for the coast shows that we do have some of those numbers venturing to the mid-70s by the start of the holiday week. Yeah, temperatures fairly mild here as we get into Tuesday and Wednesday. We will see that trail off a little bit with the next cooler dose of air coming in. But even this is not too much of a cool down through the inland locations where we're back into the upper 60s for Tuesday and Wednesday and Monday. Again, upper 70s. Time's pretty mild in the mountains. Temperatures hanging out in the mid-60s for the days to come before we go to the 50s through the middle of the holiday week. And in the desert, really not too much change in the numbers as we hold on to at least the 70s through Tuesday. For KPBS News, I'm meteorologist Melissa Constanzer.
I'm Judy Woodruff. Tonight on the NewsHour, Congress struggles to provide COVID relief and a last-minute push to fund the government. Coming up at 7 after Evening Edition on KPBS.
Ma Rainey's Black Bottom marks Chadwick Boseman's final film performance. KPBS cinema junkie Beth Accomando says he and Viola Davis are stunning in this screen adaptation of August Wilson's play.
August Wilson chronicled African-American life in his 20th century cycle of 10 plays, each focusing on a different decade. With Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, he offers a fictional story about a real blues singer in 1927 Chicago.
Crazy as I can be.
Ma Rainey is the second Wilson play Denzel Washington has produced for the screen. The first was Fences, in which he also starred and directed. He's made a commitment to adapting the entire cycle of plays to film.
It's the anchor of my professional life's work, but to have that opportunity, it's really an honor and a privilege to share his genius with the world. So I'm happy to do that.
Earlier this year, the O'Globe Theater staged Wilson's Jitney, directed by Ruben Santiago Hudson. But as a screenwriter, Santiago Hudson had the challenge of translating Ma Rainey from stage to screen.
The stage, people come to listen. In film, people come to watch. So my challenge when I wrote Ma Rainey, the movie, was how do I save the arias, as many as I can? What are the most important arias?
And those emotional arias do sing in the unique musicality of Wilson's writing.
I ain't like you, color. I got talent. Oh, me and this horn, we's tight. If my daddy had a note I was gonna turn out like this, he would have named me Gabriel.
Oh.
I'm gonna get me a band and make me some records.
As Chadwick Boseman's final film role, there's an added poignancy to his character.
I just got to finish the last part of this song. I got style.
Oh, everybody got style.
Ma Rainey may be set in the 1920s, but director George C. Wolfe gives it a pulsing immediacy.
I hate nostalgia because what nostalgia does, nostalgia puts a patina on history. And when you do that, you discredit the texture of the people who live through that moment.
Wilson's plays all deal with how the past needs to be acknowledged. Sometimes it demands respect before a new generation can move on. And sometimes it's the thing that holds you back or can't be escaped. Representing the legacy of the blues is Viola Davis's Ma Rainey.
White folk don't understand about the blues. They hear it come out, but they don't know how it got there. They don't understand that that's life's way of talking. You don't sing to feel better. You sing because that's the way of understanding life.
Wilson understood life, and now his great humanity is being vividly translated to the screen in films like Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. So treat yourself to an early holiday gift and check it out.
Something been added by that song.
Afa Kamando, KPBS News.
And we have some breaking news. Restaurants across San Diego County are being ordered to close once again. The California Attorney General sought an immediate halt to the Superior Court judge's order that allowed restaurants to reopen. The County Board of Supervisors had also sought to appeal the ruling. According to the San Diego Union-Tribune, the 4th District Court of Appeals issued a stay this evening. It comes as the county reports a new daily record for coronavirus cases. That's 3,611 cases and 14 deaths. You can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org/evening edition. Thanks for joining us. I'm Maya Trabulsi. Have a great evening.
Major funding for KPBS Evening Edition has been made possible in part by Anderson Plumbing, Heating, and Air, proud to support the mission of KPBS and privileged to serve San Diego clients. Anderson Plumbing, Heating, and Air, helping homeowners maintain drain, heating, and cooling systems since 1978. And by the Conrad Prebis Foundation, Darlene Marco Shiley, and by the following. By viewers like you. Thank you.